I'm in Hawaii enjoying its marine life, some sharks, but mostly its warm waters. And I'm reminded that even though we don't associate white sharks with Hawaii that much, they do come here and they do use these waters. But wait a minute, aren't white sharks cold water sharks? Not necessarily. Today we're going to learn some interesting facts about endothermia and how endothermia and climate change could be linked to increased sightings of white sharks in California. I'm Skyler Thomas. Welcome to Shark Minutes. Many of us, myself included, think about white sharks in the colder waters of California or South Africa, and that's not wrong. Those are very common aggregation sites. But thanks to something called endothermia, an animal has the ability to regulate its body temperature and raise it above its surrounding environmental temperature. For a fish, that's an exceptionally cool characteristic. You're talking about something that we think of as a cold-blooded animal actually being warm-bodied. But that's not the only cool thing about endothermia. And I learned something new about it a couple of years ago at a presentation at the Farallones Marine Sanctuary, where Dr. Aaron Carlisle and Dr. Chris Lowe both gave presentations that told us more about these warm-bodied sharks moving in cold oceans. Possibly the most interesting part of this particular presentation was learning that endothermia isn't something that white sharks have their entire lives. It's actually something they develop as they get older. And that makes a lot of sense when you think about the representation of shark sizes on the California coast. Personally, I often think about Southern California with the juvenile white sharks swimming amongst the surfers in LA, Manhattan Beach, so on and so forth, and Northern California as the bigger sharks that hunt out at Ano Nuevo and the Farallon Islands. In fact, it was thought that Point Conception around the middle of California was a dividing line between where the bigger sharks and the smaller sharks hang out. Now that either was never actually true, or things are changing. If you've been paying attention to the news, you've seen some reports about more shark sightings, more white shark sightings in Northern California, juvenile white sharks usually, at times of year that we don't usually see them. So what's going on? Does this just mean that white sharks are on a population boom? That theory is unlikely, considering that it's physically impossible for white sharks given their reproductive system. Remember, these aren't salmon or sardines spawning. These are apex predators. They're not meant to reproduce that quickly or give birth to that many offspring. But I digress. Back to endothermia. It's no coincidence that these younger white sharks are in Southern California and Mexico. In fact, that's fairly common amongst many species of animals, is to use warmer, shallower water as birthing and nursery grounds. This data provided by Dr. Chris Lowe shows the young white sharks following warm water currents. When the waters of Southern California cool off, they would typically follow the warm water current down into Mexico. But with the change in the oceans and the warm water currents coming up into Northern California, we see juvenile white sharks moving up into Northern California. Thus, that would explain more sightings of juvenile white sharks at times of year we aren't used to seeing white sharks. But not only that, if the temperature doesn't change in the waters of Southern California, if the cold water current that usually comes in at a certain time of year doesn't ever arrive, then you're going to have white sharks staying in that area longer, and you're going to see even more sightings in an area that already had a fair number of sightings. This is just one more example of how sensitive marine life is to the temperature of the ocean. And next time you're talking about increased sightings of white sharks, you might just think about our impact on that, because if humans are responsible for climate change, and we are, you could say that we're also responsible for the changing behavior of white sharks. I'm Skyler Thomas. Thanks for watching. Bonus time. Okay, for you hardcore shark enthusiasts who are still watching this, I'm going to take a deeper dive into the topic we just discussed, but first I would like to acknowledge the scientists whom I referenced in this video, Dr. Aaron Carlisle and Dr. Chris Lowe. If you'd like to learn more, I've provided links to both of their work in the video description. Okay, here we go. First, let's talk about my reference of climate change. Some of you might have said, hey, wait a minute, there are naturally occurring warm water changes in the ocean. That's true. In fact, when El Nino takes place, the data from these scientists supports this theory in that the sharks don't leave their warm water habitats of Southern California because the water stays warm there. Thus, people see even more white shark sightings in those areas during those naturally occurring events. Next, I mentioned that these young animals like to stay in shallow areas. Well, why would they want to do that? Well, here's your vocabulary bonus. This is called the neretic zone, which is a shallow water area above the continental shelf. Why are there so many animals there? Why is it used as a nursing ground? It's shallow, which means it's less likely that these smaller animals are going to be preyed upon by large predators. Two, we've shown already that the warmth of these waters is important to these developing animals. Three, abundant sunlight. Four, these waters are oxygen rich. Five, an abundance of smaller, maybe bottom dwelling prey that these developing juvenile white sharks can prey upon. And six, all the reasons that we have yet to discover. When you think about how important these coastal waters are to developing animals, it's funny to hear some people show shock and dismay and disappointment that there are all these fish and animals at their vacation beaches. It's the ocean. Maybe if they were called neretic zones instead of vacation beaches, people would be more aware of what they're getting into. This video also discussed the changes that take place with white sharks as they get older. So here's the other vocabulary bonus.
Ontogeny.
Which looks at the changes within an individual during its lifespan, rather than looking at the ongoing evolution of an entire species of animal. Although the young of the year, first year, and maybe even second year sharks seem to use these coastal habitats, it's not 100%. Nothing ever is. And there is fishing data showing that young white sharks have been caught up north. There is an area called the North Pacific Transition Zone that young white sharks also use. But that's a whole nother study and a whole nother topic for another time. What's next? Okay, there's a lot of bonus material in this episode. I mentioned that it is a special club to be endothermic, especially as a shark. There are only four sharks that are endothermic. They're all laminid sharks, and that would be the poor beagle, the salmon shark, the mako shark, and white shark. I also want to talk about this really cool slide from Dr. Lowe's presentation that shows the Pacific Coast Highway. This current demonstrates just how much the white sharks do prefer the warmer water when they're younger, because they're always seen inland of it. Come here. You want to be in this video? Okay. If you look closely at the photo, you can see variations in the water color showing the depth and temperature. And clearly the white sharks are hanging out right next to all of these paddle boarders in the warmer, shallower water outside of that current. Okay, that was a lot. Thanks for watching. I hope you learned something. Let me know what you did or didn't like about it. And if you did like it, give a like, subscribe, maybe show your support by ordering one of the shirts or checking out more of the videos. I'm Skylar Thomas. Thanks for watching.